Greetings to all humans from X, your favorite alien. Spherical harmonics appear in many macroscopic phenomena, acoustics, optics, and more. So, on their own, they do not prove anything inherently quantum. However, in the experiments of Marsio Salcuni, these harmonics emerge through a discrete method of measurement. And that changes everything. The way the data are collected, point-by-point binary, makes the connection with quantum mechanics far more natural and meaningful than a purely classical explanation. Here's why. Salcuni does not measure a continuous field, but rather interrogates space with a sensor that responds discretely, north-south. By accumulating these binary collapses, shapes emerge that perfectly mirror atomic orbitals. And the correspondence is not just aesthetic, but logical. Now let us go even deeper and attempt a bold association, one that will reveal its true logical power as you continue watching the videos linked to this research. N, principal quantum number. Imagine turning a knob that adjusts the sensitivity of the sensor, its voltage. Each measurement at a different voltage corresponds to a different energy level. With lower voltage, the sensor must be closer to the magnet, while with higher voltage, it can detect the field from farther away. The example also applies to electromagnets, where we have the possibility of varying the voltage directly at the source, something we cannot do with permanent magnets, but which we can achieve through the sensor. Thus, just as in atomic orbitals, the principal quantum number n governs the levels, size, and scale of the distributions, here the reading threshold and distance define which layers of the magnetic field emerge. But there is one more element that must be included. Something absent in quantum mechanics, the magnet itself under analysis. It contributes to the creation of these numbers just as much as the sensor. For example, the type of magnet, neodymium, ferrite, etc., its crystallization, and its overall strength must all be taken into account. And in many of these experiments, the observed shapes arise from the interaction of two magnets in precise configurations. This too must be integrated into the association with N. In conclusion, these factors, sensor intensity, magnet type, and system configuration, combine to represent the equivalent of the principal quantum number N in this macroscopic model. L, angular quantum number. In quantum mechanics, L determines the family of shapes, spherical, two-lobed, four-petaled, and so on. In Salcuni's protocol, by maintaining certain geometric conditions, such as fixing the measurement axis, specific families of shapes appear, exactly as L selects the orbital type. Here, L corresponds to the orientation of the sensor with respect to the magnet's axis of magnetization, or of the entire magnetic system under study. And again, just as with N, we must also consider the magnet's own characteristics. For single magnets, this includes the shape and the type of magnetization. For systems of multiple magnets, we must also add the distance and relative orientation between them. In other words, the topology of the magnetic system. M, magnetic quantum number. The magnetic quantum number M determines the orientation and the component of the angular momentum along the z-axis. In other words, the orientation of the shape in space. At this stage, you are no longer moving just the sensor. The entire instrument, including the scanning plane, rotates in space. In this way, the same shape, for example, a two-lobed pattern, can appear oriented vertically, horizontally, or diagonally. In this case, the magnet or magnetic system is already encompassed by the motion itself, and therefore nothing additional needs to be included in the definition of M. S, spin quantum number. The binary behavior of the sensor, north versus south, 1 versus 0, echoes the concept of spin as a discrete value. Of course, this is not the intrinsic quantum spin of a particle, but functionally it serves the same logical role, a binary choice that contributes to the final configuration. Here as well, the magnet or magnetic system provides the field and its polarities, which are precisely what is being analyzed, so there is no need to consider it separately for S. Recap, assigning quantum numbers to the magnetic scenario. We can now summarize the correspondence as follows. N energy levels, defined by the distance and voltage of the sensor with respect to the magnet, plus the type and strength of the individual magnet or magnetic system. L, fixed measurement angle of the sensor, family of shapes, plus the magnet's shape and type of magnetization, if a single magnet, and for multiple magnets, the distance and orientation between them, that is, the topology of the magnetic system. M, rotation of the entire measurement plane, spatial orientation of the shape. S, binary spin state, north-south detected by the sensor. It is crucial to emphasize that even when Marsio uses two magnets, he is not representing molecular orbitals, but always atomic orbitals. Certain orbital families cannot emerge with a single magnet. They require the added complexity of a minimal magnetic system. So, generalizing this entire discussion, when you see the drawing of an atomic orbital in a textbook, you might imagine a smooth, continuous surface. In reality, it is the result of an accumulation of discrete points. Each point is an event, a possible position of the electron, and millions of points together create the familiar cloud. Here, the same logical and graphical method is applied. The sensor detects individual binary points in space. By accumulating many points, a constellation emerges that, when properly connected, defines a stable perimeter, the recognizable figure we call a magnetic orbital. Important, if instead you keep the raw analog values, different voltages without thresholding, you obtain a distribution that is hard to visualize. By fixing an intrinsic threshold, north-south, because the sensor's reference voltage is constant, you make results coherent and comparable. That is why the perimeter appears sharply. You don't get the classical scattered cloud of dots. However, even with the binary method, the most accurate visualization would still be a particle cloud whose particles have varying magnetic field intensities, analogous to the electron probability distribution in quantum mechanics. So the parallel works like this. Atomic orbitals are probability clouds, figures made of points. Magnetic orbitals are maps of field intensity, figures made of points. In both cases, what we observe is the hidden order in space made visible by a measurement procedure, and that is nothing new in science. Every major advance has followed the invention of a new instrument or measurement method. In other words, Salcuni does not simply draw the field. He quantizes space with point-by-point binary measurements, and from the collection of those dots emerges, just like in atomic orbitals, a geometry made of lobes, nodes, and tori that mirrors the spherical harmonics and the logic of quantum numbers. This is not a marginal detail. It is conceptual proof that the parallel with quantum mechanics is far more natural and logical than a purely classical explanation. And here we can add another very strong point in favor of Salcuni's final thesis, that all of this makes much more sense when thought of in quantum mechanical terms rather than classical mechanics. But don't worry, at the end of everything, we will perform a huge final comparison. And please, if you want to join us in exploring this new macro quantum world, subscribe, hit like, and share. It really matters to us. Thank you. Greetings to all humans from X, your favorite alien.